Coming to you live from Houston, Texas at the Idea Synthesis Workshop at the Lunar and Planetary Institute. My name is Jason Kessler. I am the co-lead for the Partnership and Participatory Engagement session this morning. I am the program executive of the Asteroid Grand Challenge based in headquarters. My partner in crime, Jen Gastetic, is the program exec for prizes and challenges. And we're joined by Joe Gard as moderator, who's based here at the Johnson Space Center. To get things started, it's good to be back. We were here at the end of October and had a little hiatus. And I'm really grateful for everybody that was willing to travel back and join us in person. We have a number of folks that will be doing so virtually as well. And really look forward to a lively discussion. You can see up front now is the agenda that we've got. And the way we've got it organized, there are three sections. We'll start with Mike O'Hara from Aerojet, Bo Naz from Goddard, and Charlie Chafer. They'll all have 10 minutes each, and then we'll open it up to 15 minutes of questions for each of them, have a 10-minute break, followed by Chris Lewicki, Scott Sevcik, David Gump, Eric Mum. Again, open it up to 15 minutes of questions, followed by another break. Then we'll have David Gustin, Margaret Race, Jill Lepore, Tony Freeman, and Jean-Claude Piedbouf. Again, 15 minutes of questions after their presentations. Again, a break. And then we want to open it up into a lively conversation. The idea here really is to take these ideas and pull apart how we might be able to move forward in the planning for both the mission and the grand challenge. I'd like to direct you to the hashtag Asteroid Partners if you're following us online, and join in with questions through that or through the Ustream live chat. To set the stage real quickly, you've probably seen this slide. It's the Venn diagram of the Asteroid Initiative. It's made up of both the Asteroid Redirect Mission and the Asteroid Grand Challenge. We were really excited when the RFI got released that we were able to include this section that we're speaking about today, and that's the partnership and participatory engagement. How can we, in both the mission and the grand challenge, figure out ways to bring in new, fresh ideas and innovate on some concepts to help us do this better? It's obvious that the overlap is in the NEO observation and manipulation or engagement around an asteroid, but excitingly, there's opportunities for partnership and engagement both in the mission, whether it's the robotic piece or the crewed mission aspects, as well as the underpinnings of the grand challenge to enable us to do the work that we've already doing better and accelerate that work. So a couple of desired outcomes to set the stage for this morning. I think it's important that we get a shared understanding of how this partnership effort can really benefit both the mission and the grand challenge. Ultimately, again, we're really wanting to have a rich dialogue, and I'm hoping that the structure that we've set for this session today is going to enable that. And if it turns out that we're not having the discussion, I'm certainly open to change in the schedule around a bit so that we can get into the conversation that's really going to lead to the findings that both the mission and the grand challenge are looking for. Ultimately, the idea is to be able to feed this into the session tomorrow, the plenary session, and that can then be pulled into the mission planning moving forward. And as Jen and I continue to work on this co-created implementation plan for the Grand Challenge, this really is our first step of engaging. And then ultimately, we want to be able to find what our next steps and actions are going to be. And so we really want to have the discussion to pull out the salient points that we can then move forward with as we continue this process. Another word, Char, I had to do it, just to kind of set the tone. I know it's early for some, and those that are around the world, maybe it's really late. But just to set the context of what we were talking about here. I'm not going to read through all this, but these were the questions that we asked in the RFI. And these, for the most part, are what are going to be discussed today. Not every presenter focused on all the these bullets, because that was not the requirement. But this is what we sent out in the RFI to kind of trigger the thinking. And so let us, from there, turn it over to our first speaker so that we can get started. It's going to be Michael O'Hara from Aerojet Rocketdyne talking about the initiative Unique Opportunities. That one is forward.
Good morning. Thank you for having me here. I am the Director for Civil Space Propulsion. I work in Washington, D.C. in the Wash Ops office. What is participatory engagement? What does it mean to us at Aerojet Rocketdyne? Well, it's really three categories in the way we see it. It's broad and diverse participation, sustained multi-mission engagement, and doing business differently. It's kind of timely for us, as most of you might be aware. We just had an acquisition of Rocketdyne, so we're internally looking at ways to do business cheaper, more effectively, and meet the cost and customer needs as we move forward. Under the broad and diverse participation, we see participation definitely with the community, other agencies, NOAA, NASA, FAA, the commercial space, entrepreneurs, and that whole business segment that's rapidly growing. Universities, international space agencies, and industrial partners, private government, observatories and laboratories, Congress, and for this particular endeavor, the United Nations. This is a world issue, potentially with asteroids, and there is international interest. Sustained multi-mission engagement. A single mission does not result in real engagement opportunities. We cannot afford one-off programs anymore. Multiple missions on timescales consistent with the needs of the community. So we need to be able to do things and touch the community and bring them in and engage them. And of course, we have to be cost effective. Broad market applications beyond intended primary objectives. So like I said, we can't do one-offs. Whatever we do, we have to have a broader scope in mind, get the most bang for the buck to keep these things going. Repeated broad community and public engagement through workshops, industrial conferences, industry association, XPRIZE competition. It's a lot like a shape and capture if you're a BD person. A lot of the same theories, the same objectives need to apply to what we're doing here. And of course, doing business differently. Offer incentives to participate in appropriate for each community prize, IP ownership, property ownership, etc. Minimize or reduce the barriers to participation and schedule costs. You know, we need to get things going a lot quicker. It costs industry a lot of money to respond to things and, you know, a lot of time and energy. And from the agency perspective, it would really help us if they could expedite things and not be so demanding, but yet be reactive and proactive and move things along much quicker. It will reduce the overall costs. We need to emphasize applicability of technology development paths to multiple exploration goals and non-users. So, you know, spin-offs. You know, I'm a former Langley guy and was involved in a lot of spin-offs in my work there. So the more bang for the buck that we can do with these programs, the more we're going to bring in people. And we need to leverage industry's investments of existing available high TRL capability to expedite the program. So if there's something in the hopper that has a reasonably high TRL, let's not go back to the drawing board. You know, let's use what we have. Let's take minimum resources to get it to the TRL level that we need to move things forward. But most importantly, participatory engagement requires affordable, sustained, and multi-mission opportunities for participation in diverse communities. How does Aerojet Rocketdyne approach participatory engagement? Well, we look at how we can do things differently. Affordability of contained missions with multiple player involvement. The more people we can bring in, the more congressional, advocacy we can get, the more people we touch, the more, people that are on the payroll. You know, it's a different environment, guys. You know, we can't have one big program and minimal participation. We're going to have to share everything, and that's one thing that Aerojet Rocketdyne, we're looking at doing, is expanding and bringing in as much expertise and people and things we can do to help our programs be sustained. What are we doing to help others do things? Broad scope of applicability. So, you know, whatever we do, it needs to be applicable to multiple things. It's all about bang for the buck. And if we can keep that in mind, I think we're going to have a good chance at things. And we need to focus on the industrial return. So, you know, I have board of directors. You know, we have stockholders. As much as I love my job, we all don't do it for free. So we have to be able to sell what we do inside as much as outside. We need to focus engagement on technology, science, and policy. We definitely need to have a STEM component, academia component, the entrepreneurial space folks, the venture capitalists, media outreach campaigns. We need to do things differently than we have been doing. And things we are doing will ultimately support going to Mars. So, you know, the objective is to get to Mars, and we can't do it right out of the box. So we got to take step by step. So whatever we do has to build to an objective, and that objective for us, the way we see it, is ultimately getting to Mars. So what do we do once there is a program? Well, we need to promote the affordability. Okay, so right now, this is the least expensive path to exploration beyond low Earth orbit. There's no lander required. It tests several key technologies in a realistic environment that have applicability to a Mars mission. How do we use asteroids once it's in place? Well, broad exploitation is the key to reduce cost, and to engage non-traditional entities, entrepreneurs. Google Prize for Asteroids Resource Utilization, engage universities, CubeSat missions to asteroids, student suggestions and experiments, and engage the scientific community. It's going to be imperative that the science and human space guys work together for whatever we do and leverage each other for the most outcome. And of course, we need to keep this sold. Like any program you win, we need to work to keep it sold in this environment. And this program asserts NASA as a leader in space exploration, which we all want. Defined mission will encourage infusion of young talent, which we all need in this industry, and encourage interest in science and engineering. The technologies developed can be used for cargo transportation for human missions to Mars, and it's SLS and Orion logistics support. You know, it gives the program something to do in the near term and keeps things moving. And it enables a mission cadence that will maintain public engagement with its visibility. Approach is critical to the vision. So for us, because we're a propulsion company, we've been working with the architecture specifically. Oh, sorry. Okay, sorry about that. So we have in-space transportation, efficient movement of assets and supplies, and multiple customer applicability. Aerojet Rocketdyne's sustainability and space transportation approach for exploration. As you can see, it's cross-cutting. What we want to do, and our piece to this, can apply to DoD orbit raising, robotic missions, SLS Orion, planetary defense, satellite servicing, repositioning of assets, and situational awareness. You can contact myself, Michael Hara, or Joe Cassie. We'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next up is Bo Naz from Goddard. Welcome.
Okay, well, I'm going to tell you a little bit about some work that we've been doing at NASA Goddard for the last few years on satellite servicing partnerships. I'm not going to talk a lot about the satellite servicing activity because that's not why we're here, but maybe try and make some parallels to what's going on here and what we've been trying to do with servicing and tell you about the partnership approach that we've been working towards. And then talk a little bit about, you know, just my perspective on some of the partnership opportunities that might be available for this mission. So as I said, I'm from the Satellite Servicing Capabilities Office. We've been working since 2011 on a public-private partnership to do satellite servicing in geosynchronous orbit. Okay, so there's some parallels here. There's some complete differences here. We've talked a lot about how we need to do COTS-like things and bring private industry in to make NASA missions cheaper and more sustainable. Satellite servicing is kind of a similar concept. We know there's a strong commercial market existing for satellite servicing. We know there's some technology development that still needs to happen. Our goal is to work with private industry to develop the final stages of that technology and go fly missions that are beneficial to both the government and the commercial partner. So the public-private partnership that we've put together is one where there's a lot of skin in the game from both sides. There's not a lot of government intervention in what happens on the private sector side. And there's a guarantee that the private sector has rights to their intellectual property that they've developed in this partnership. So I think those are important things. This is definitely a mission-based partnership. And unlike the asteroid industry, mining industry, it's a very mature customer base. There's a direct return on investment in the immediate future. So maybe there's not direct parallel. We'll have to talk more about that. So the approach is a cooperative research and development agreement, or CRADA, combined with a standard FAR running in parallel. And the way that works for us is we work with the partner to develop the technologies necessary to complete the mission. We do that mostly through the CRADA. We have a separate FAR that is enables us to do some bartering and some exchange of money, but not a whole lot. Most of the work is done under the cooperative research agreement, and it's kind of much more like a 50-50 split of the cost of going into this. So what that does for the government is it enables us to fly missions cheaper on the government side, but it also forces industry, or enables industry, depending on how you look at it, to go off and open new markets. Okay, so I'm not going to talk a lot about CRADA. If you, I encourage you to go look at it. It's an alternative to Space Act that we found more suitable for the servicing type of activity. So, what are some areas where the government and industry can partner? Clearly, there's a lot of work in solar arrays and electric propulsion. And so, here's the question: does the government need to pay for the entire development? Does the government need to pay for the entire build cycle and test cycle? Is there some commercial interest entity who has something to gain financially by having a space flight proven system and selling it to maybe commercial industry or maybe the government? Is there investment that a partner could make that could help the government make this mission more affordable? Is there asteroid boulder capture mechanisms? Capture mechanisms? I don't know that there is. Are there mining tools? I don't know that there are. But certainly these are the kind of things that a partner could invest in, partner with the government and fly, and potentially at very low cost to the government, and while guaranteeing intellectual property rights for that partner through the CRADA. So the other idea, this one I think is the most obvious one, for the asteroid mining community and for the planetary defense community, we need to partner on how we're collecting data, or at least we could. I'd like to see us partner on how we're collecting data, and one option is a data buy. There's another option, which would be if NASA does decide that we need to fly new space telescopes, that instead of seeing NASA and private industry as competing to build a scout type mission, we could actually work together, pool resources, do more for less, those kinds of things. So those are the kind of things that I think we could do using this approach. So here's just one example of a data buy. So if we want to go find asteroids that are coming to Earth and our low delta V return, the place we need to look is not as they're flying by Earth and not going to come back for another 100 years. It'd be nice if we could go look where they are now, which is slowly looping in. These would be the few asteroids, or the very many asteroids, actually, that are in very Earth-like orbits with long synoptic periods and therefore low delta V to return to Earth. These are great candidates for ARM. They're awesome candidates for asteroid mining and that kind of activity. So just one example, maybe a partner provides a telescope and NASA provides a bus, or vice versa, and we go off and do this scouting mission together. Just something to think about. This is kind of the kind of partnership arrangement that you could do with this approach. So in conclusion, I think clearly public-private partnerships can yield significant benefits to both parties. There's a great history of those things. The geocom industry started that way with ECHO. The COTS is a great example. Hopefully satellite servicing in the near future will be another example. Don't forget, when you're looking at partnership opportunities, it's not just SpaceX, it's not just far-based contracts and grants and the traditional things, but CRADA's an option too. And so if anyone wants to talk to us about this approach, come see me after. I'll give you my contact information. I'll put you in touch with the right people.
Great.
That's all.
Thank you both. Next up, we have Charlie Schaefer from Space Services Holdings. Hi, Charlie.
Good. Good. See you.
Thank you. Morning, everybody. My name is Charlie Schaefer. I'm the CEO of Space Services Holdings. I was delighted to see the topic of today's discussion, because I believe we do have a mission that's ongoing that is a public-private partnership and is widely focused on participation. So I'd like to talk to you a little bit about it. I think it might be a model. So everybody knows about solar sails. This is really a dream come true for me and for everybody back to Galileo that NASA decided to release as part of its technology demonstration mission program, the Sunjammer mission. Solar sails aren't, this won't be the first sail mission ever flown. The Japanese Icarus spacecraft is still flying. This will be the largest mission ever flown, 1,300 meters squared. It's designed to answer all questions about sails as flight hardware that's worthy of your consideration for future missions. So Sunjammer has, as I mentioned, it's a NASA-funded solar sail mission. It's focused on technology demonstration, and within the procurement, the RFP and the award, there were infusion requirements. We'll talk mostly about those. 2014, maybe early 2015, launch were co-manifested on the Discover launch, and we will fly the sail to L1, where we'll calibrate some space weather sensors that have been provided by the UK Space Agency, and then move on out to a sub-L1 position about twice as far from Earth to demonstrate the value of sails, one value of which is doubling the warning time for solar storms. We also have a global participation component, which we head up. So the team is, of course, NASA providing the funding and the technical oversight. The contractors, Lagarde in Tustin, California. They've built and flown 150 inflatable and deployable missions in space, so they're not newcomers. Micro Aerospace Solutions of Melbourne, my company, and then, of course, NOAA as one of the infusion partners. So the opportunity here is that we are one of the first ever commercial rights holders to a NASA mission. How did we get it? We asked for it. In the RFP, the infusion requirement envisioned participation by commercial partners. We provided an offer that includes direct cash payments to the mission to fly some of our payload and an extensive EPO outreach effort centered around the website And in exchange for that, we now have the rights to monetize web traffic and to provide sponsorship opportunities throughout the mission. A little bit about us. We go back about 30 years plus. A gentleman named Deke Slayton, who lived not far from here and worked even closer to here, was our president then. In 82, we conducted the first privately funded launch into outer space. Since that time, we've been busy. Many of you may have heard of Celestis, the world's first public participatory space mission. We've flown a dozen flights, have two more scheduled, and we've put more than 1,000 people symbolically into space, which I like to say is more than any government has done. Solar sails, the accomplishments to date include the deployment of the sail, size of the sail on the ground. And for those of you that know sail craft, you'll know that it's harder to do it in 1G than it is in 0G. We have worked with NOAA over the course of 5 competitively awarded contracts to help them define a sail-based approach to a data buy for commercial space weather. And back in the early days when we were first working on solar sails, we entered into a Space Act agreement with NASA Langley at their request to share some ideas about deployable booms. So here's the core of what I'd like to speak about today. It's our business model, and it does include sort of 3 components. The first is that you, and this is why I think it's applicable not just to sails, but to any technology. Asteroid retrieval has all of these components. So the first thing you have to have is a real and a compelling space mission. We have a motto at our company, no cartoons, only flight. The mission can be compelling on the basis of where it's going, who's on board, or what it's doing. Any of those components can make a compelling space mission, but remember, it has to be real. The second component is make the world aware of what you're doing. You do that through earned media. Of course, our most recent Celestis flight, where we launched Scotty and Gordo Cooper and 300 other folks, attracted more than 1 billion media impressions, and our website and our webcast was an equal number of unique impressions. So getting earned media is easy for compelling space missions, if you know how to do it. It's more difficult if it's a boring space mission, I'll give you that, but it is a key component of global awareness. The second is through advertising. We are a Groupon Evergreen partner. We do pay-per-click on Google. We have a broad scope of methods by which we let the world know that we're involved in a compelling space mission. The final component of the business model, which again I think is relevant for missions going forward, is pretty simple. Take money wherever it exists. So we have traditional revenues, we have US government customers, we have commercial customers that buy data or buy hardware or buy demonstrations. But we also have what I call non-traditional revenues. We monetize internet unique visitors. I was asked to give a testimony to the Senate Space Committee a few years back. I told Senator Brownback that if NASA had a shopping cart on its Mars landing web pages, they probably could have financed subsequent missions. I'm glad that they don't, because that's my business. But taking space interested web traffic and learning how to monetize it is something we've been doing for 15 years. Sponsorship. We've done missions for 20th Century Fox, Nescafe, Barrels Writings Instruments in England, and a number of other key sponsors. And then finally, Memorial Spaceflight, certainly a non-traditional revenue stream. So in the form of solar sail commercial infusion, the first application I've already mentioned, this is the outcome of a study we did for NOAA that shows how a data purchase approach to sail-delivered space weather information is A, lower cost, B, more comprehensive, and C, provides at least double the warning time. And if you're a nuclear power plant trying to shut down during a solar storm because you're worried about the grid overheating, that extra 45 minutes matters. If you're piloting an airplane over the poles and you need to come down to a lower altitude or even land, having that extra time matters. if you're in this space station and you need to get to the Russian side of it because it's more heavily shielded, that extra time matters. So I'll skip communications. I'll talk about entertainment missions. Certainly anybody that's ever seen an America's Cup race understands the concept of logos on the sail. We've already tested the paint. We know how to do it. We know how to cover X percent of sails and not reduce the propulsive reflectivity. It's just a matter of time once sails get going that you'll see the race around the moon. That actually is what Sunjammer is named for. Back in June, we announced that Sir Arthur Clarke's DNA will be part of our cosmic archive on the Sunjammer mission. And Clarke wrote Sunjammer as a story about a race around the moon. So space weather, I'll stick. Let's say one thing about space weather. This is a chart provided by the new director of NOAA, Dr. Catherine Sullivan, Assistant Secretary of Commerce, last year. Everybody in commercial space is seeking the hockey stick. Many people are promising the hockey stick in terms of just get started and you'll see dramatic growth in the use. Here's the hockey stick. The consumer growth in the Space Weather Prediction Center's subscription service as we become a more wired planet and dependent upon space weather information creates an obvious market. Game changer, I've described that. And so what are we doing with Sunjammer? We call it explore, educate, and entertain. The exploration component is the proof of the technology. We're going to take it, fly it into deep space. Educate, we have kids, school students, from Tustin, California to Zambia participating in the mission. And remember, we're 14 to 18 months out from the flight. You only heard about Curiosity, you all heard about Curiosity well in advance. The world learned about Curiosity 7 days in advance. So we're in the process of building that crescendo. I guarantee you when there are 6 HD cameras and 1 GoPro flyaway camera taking images of that fully deployed sail out in deepest space, there isn't a sports bar on the planet that's not going to have that on CNN, and people are going to see that. Finally, and that slips over into the entertainment component. We have the music of Sunjammer, we have launch events, we have any number of things planned, and we're beginning to implement them. Celestis, we're flying payload. So I'll finish up here with what my thoughts about what is relevant for today's topic. The first is that innovative partnerships can succeed. There's some hiccups along the way. I thought for certain when we were announced the winner that I was going to have a huge, I'll say it, battle at NASA dragging a Space Act agreement out of them to allow me to do the things I'd won in the procurement. Not a bit. COTS and new ways of doing things took hold. We have an agreement. We have the rights. Those rights include don't mess with our mission, which we understand. All of our activities occur post the accomplishment of the NASA mission. But there was a lot of give and take in terms of what is the proper format to do that, but we can succeed. The science and technical goals of the mission came first. The infusion between NOAA and us accomplished also. And we figured out a bunch of new missions and things that we can use solar sails for. I mentioned space weather. Obviously, anybody that's been to an asteroid conference knows that sails have a role there. But again, I will say that it is not the model is not unique to solar sails. Asteroid sail missions already in planning. Public engagement, technologies, and methods evolving as almost as fast as the mission technologies. We're trying to keep up with developing apps, with developing new forms of interaction for our public. The more folks, the more eyeballs we show on this mission, the more dollars flow to us and the more dollars that flow to the mission. So that's me, I'm here in Houston and happy to be a part of today's program. Thanks.
Thank you, Charlie. Fantastic. All right. So we've got now 15 minutes of questions. I want to throw it out first. Do we have anything that's come online, Joe?
No, not yet.
Okay. We've got our speakers in the room. Any questions, ideas piqued from our audience members? We have mic runners. Okay. We do have, oh, please.
So I have a question about solar sails and gravity, or planetary defense. There you go. Oh. So presumably you can use a solar sail like a kite?
Absolutely. I mean, it uses the photonic pressure.
Can you start again?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, you can. It's a in-space propulsion system that has a variety of applications. The sunlight is, the photonic pressure is constant, so we have to end up jibing and tacking just like you use a sailboat. But that's what we'll be demonstrating, is that maneuverability. And it can be attached to, you know, it depends on the size of the sail, the thickness of the material that you use, but certainly that's an application.
Actually, I have a question on that, the solar sail, too. I'm not sure when the launch is of the Sunjammer, but have you already started with your public outreach? Have you gotten a following already? Have you started to see people hitting the site and things like that?
Love that question. Sunjammermission.com. And yes, we have a large number of people that are already on the mailing list. We also Facebook and tweet on a regular basis about the mission. We've done a number of media rollouts. We did a press conference in June where we announced Sir Arthur. We got another one coming up in December when we'll announce the first major consumer products marketing partner that we have. I can't do that today, but we have that as well. And so we have a series of planned events and announcements, some of which I think are pretty cool, coming to the point of the launch. To answer your question, the launch is currently on the manifest for Q4 of 2014. My guess is, having been doing this stuff for 30 years, it'll move to the right a little bit. But we are a secondary. I have a t-shirt that says being a secondary sucks. But in this case, we're a happy secondary. And so we'll be co-manifested with the Discover spacecraft that's flying for that time.
You had a photograph of a band, and you mentioned the music of Sunjammer. What would you explain more?
There's sort of two components to that. One is on our website in Q1 next year, we're going to open it up for everybody's playlists. Mine includes Come Sail Away, Here Comes the Sun, all that kind of stuff, old guy music. Others are picking other music. But we also are lining up a series of celebrities who are doing songs for the mission. They'll be part of what we call the Cosmic Archive, sort of like the Voyager mission, only in this instance, some of the performers will be performing the music for the first time in some of their concerts. I wish I could tell you more. I'm dying to tell you more because it will increase the traffic on our website. But we do plan both broad-based participation, where anybody will have people submit songs that we'll put on the Cosmic Archive as well. So broad-based public participation as well as some entertainment.
I guess this question is for Jason or Jen. We heard some different kinds of partnership ideas, different ways of engaging with NASA. From the program perspective, what are you guys more amenable to, for just grand challenge type activities or ones that cross the other side into the mission? How do you guys see structuring that?
So I represent the Grand Challenge, and so I'm listening with my ears for that, number one. But number two, as the lead for this session, I'm listening for all the ideas that can then be put into the findings for the mission as well. So while I do wear the Grand Challenge hat, and Jen helps me with that hat, this is about the asteroid initiative right now, and so it's pulling out all the best ideas that can be laid on the table and factored into planning for both.
Can these solar sails be configured in an array so that you can use the solar pressure and the Yarkovsky effect to your advantage when trying to move an asteroid?
I went to the Foreign Service School at Georgetown. I'd have to ask the engineers that question. Sorry.
I'll jump in. We've got a question from Mike Helton at HADAYANO on Twitter. His question is, has there been or is there a consideration to involve a group of philanthropists to partner with NASA to supply funds? And I'll throw that out there to our speakers, since you've been out engaging in partnership, has discussion with philanthropists crossed your mind or actually been successful? Yes. Yeah.
From our perspective, we generally approach them as investors, not philanthropists. But a huge part of what we do is through 501c3s. We're partnered with the Conrad Foundation. We're working with other C3s around the world. And so it would be easy to try to vector interested people who are looking for that tax deductibility and into the education programs. I should also mention, if I may, that we've been working very closely with our partners at the Marshall Space Flight Center and EPO. They've been unbelievably supportive. They've asked us to do some events that they didn't have the budget for. We had the budget to do it, so that in that way we're also trying to benefit the mission, making education and public outreach opportunities happen.
I haven't personally talked with such people, but I know that there are conversations like that going on. NASA has great potential to do philanthropic things. One example would be, you know, helping solve world hunger, for example, by using space assets to measure soil nitrogen composition and things like that. And I have certainly heard of philanthropic organizations meeting with NASA, discussing with NASA ways that we could partner to do things that those kind of organizations would be interested in.
Mm-hmm. Well, this is actually still a response, but I've talked to a number of people who seem to have an interest in promoting the idea of education. I mean, in this country in particular, I think there's a role for philanthropy in providing educational tools for schools to embrace this whole thing.
Yeah, so one from online. The question is about engaging universities as well as foreign countries or foreign space entities who are interested in participating in that kind of thing. It's kind of generic. I'll just open that up to any of the presenters so far.
I alluded to the fact that we have two space weather instruments, magnetometers that's no bigger than this. It's an amazing machine, and a solar wind analyzer, both provided by University College and I believe it's King's College in London through the UK Space Agency. So Sunjammer is also involving foreign, non-US space agencies.
Mute on.
And universities.
I think this question is for Mr. Schaefer specifically.
I
don't quite understand the full revenue model for your company, but can you talk a little bit about proportionally how much of it comes from government sources versus private, and on the private side, do you see that source of revenue extensible to the orders of magnitude more expensive missions where we're talking about human missions to deep space?
Taking the second part first, there are companies out there that are talking about using the same model that we're implementing for human missions. I have to say that the jury's out on that, just because we're in the very early parts of doing these types of missions. There's no question that if you look at the Olympics or you look at the World Cup or you look at any sort of high visibility activity, the dollars available to monetize the eyeballs that are on those events are quite high and at the level that permit that. Our money is mostly private. The good news is that the mission is paid for by, for Sunjammer, the mission is paid for by the government. We are flowing additional dollars and activities into it, but we're not getting any government dollars out of Sunjammer. It's all risk capital involved at this point. I think that going forward, the model can really apply across any space mission as long as you deliver what people are looking for, which is a compelling experience that's handled professionally and provides a reason for people to stay on your website and click through to website users. Some of our follow-on missions, the space weather mission, for example, with NOAA, envisions that being a data buy, very much like the imagery business went from Landsat only to government data buys for imagery. And so we believe that we can make a case for lowering the cost to the government of providing that service by using the platform to serve multiple revenue streams as opposed to be dedicated only to the government mission. So I believe the model kind of can extend in all those ways. Having said that, you got to get out there and actually do it, and then we can have the discussion. So we're looking forward to a really busy year, followed by some additional implementation activities.
Hi, this question's for Bo. So when in your talk, you talked about, you know, convincing commercial partners to come on and, you know, invest in what you're doing. So traditionally, NASA's the funder for activities and providing these spacecraft. So what have you found that you have to do differently or think differently as NASA to convince, you know, let's say the larger holders of the technology to invest their own money to, you know, be able to see a business case and move forward with, you know, projects like you're doing in space?
Yeah, what does NASA have to do differently to be a good partner, I think, is part of the question. I think there's two main things that come to mind. The first is NASA has to accept that private industry knows what they're doing, that they know how to build spacecraft, and that we don't need to have a lot of oversight into what they're doing. We can trust that if they have skin in the game, they're going to do the job right, and that we don't need to make something that would cost private industry $100 million, cost the government $300 million, just because we make them do more paper. So I think that's one of the things we need to back off and let industry do what it's good at. I think the second thing is much more challenging, and especially in today's climate. It's hard for the government to be a good partner when we don't have stable year-to-year programmatic funding. And so for something like Space Station and COTS, the government can be a good partner because we're committed. So certainly we need to be committed, and we need to not be subject to the whims of change in Washington. And that's much more challenging. Is there a question?
Yeah, I think the other part is how much effort do you have to put into understanding the business cases?
So the other question was, how much effort do you need to put into understanding the business case? I think that's a great question. I think we really, really have to understand it well. because we're making decisions now that are going to impact that business case. And in order to bring partners on, I think they need to know that we understand their business case. So in the mining asteroid mining example, right, we need to make sure that we understand the phases of their program and that we're doing things now that move them forward in those phases and not just giving them setbacks and those kind of things. So a very vague answer, I know, but I think it's very important that we understand what motivates our partner.
Yeah, I have another one for Charles. The question is, school participation, what levels? Is it high school, community college, universities?
All of the above. If you go to sunjammermission.com, you'll see about a little video of about, I think, 30 Zambian kids who are in elementary school all going, "We are going to space." We had high school and middle schoolers into the LaGuard facility to see the sail under construction, and they actually witnessed the deployment test as part of their advanced science activities. Universities will be announcing a couple of partnerships, both in technology and in non-technology components of the mission down the road. So I think, you know, we're about trying to evangelize the mission wherever we can, and certainly a key component of it is the education side of things that we're doing. So we've got a full-time director of education that was a high school teacher in Houston and went on to run an urban debate league in Minnesota and is now full-time working, doing our blog. We have a university student at Ohio State University that runs a really cool Facebook called Space Weather Trackers, and he writes blogs for us about space weather that are targeted at students of all ages.
Okay, folks, that will conclude our questions for now. We'll have a 10-minute break. I just want to remind everybody that we're going to have discussion period at the end of all the speakers. So if you have thoughts, other things get triggered during the break, that there's going to be an opportunity to continue this conversation. So thanks to our presenters. We'll have a 10-minute break and then start up again at 9:05. Thank you.